to St. Thomas the Apostle, Finsbury Park. Today, our children and young people are taking part in our worship, and we're going to hear one of the great stories of the Old Testament, how three extraordinary women saved the life of a wee baby. And it involves making a miniature ark out of papyrus leaves and lining it with tar to make it waterproof. Our prayer for today will come from the church in Ghana. So our thanks go today to our reader, Stav Stavroulis, our prayer leader, Chris Collins, and to all who have given us recordings and pictures, and the team who have woven them together. Welcome. Welcome. Our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We have come together in the name of Christ to offer praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves in service to God. And so, as beginning of our worship, we prepare to make our confession to the God who loves us. How often have I longed to gather your children as a hen gathers her chickens under her wings, says the Lord, but you would not come to me. Let us come to God and pray. Loving God, we are sorry for the times when we've been careless of other people, for the kind words we could have said but didn't, for not helping when we could have helped, for forgetting about you and all the love you give us. Forgive us all that is past. Let your light shine in us and help us to be your people. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Prayer for the day from the church in Ghana. O Lord our God, listening to us here, you accept also the prayers of our sisters and brothers in Africa, Asia and the Pacific, the Americas and Europe. We are all one in prayer. So may we, as one, rightly carry out your commission to witness and to love in the church and throughout the world. Accept our prayers graciously, even when they are somewhat strange. They are offered in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus, chapter 2, verses 1 to 10. Now a man of the tribe of Levi married a Levite woman, and she became pregnant and gave birth to a son. When she saw that he was a fine child, she hid him for 3 months. But when she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and coated it with tar and pitch. Then she placed the child in it and put it among the reeds along the bank of the Nile. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. Then Pharaoh's daughter went down to the Nile to bathe, and her attendants were walking along the river bank. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her female slave to get it. She opened it and saw the baby. He was crying and she felt sorry for him. "This is one of the Hebrew babies," she said. Then his sister asked Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get one of the Hebrew women to nurse the baby for you?" "Yes, go," she answered. So the girl went to the baby's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this baby and nurse him for me, and I will pay you." So the woman took the baby and nursed him. When the child grew older, she took him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. She named him Moses, saying, "I drew him out of the water." Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward, and whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Now, the gift of a cold drink of cold water is a vital thing when you are thirsty, seriously thirsty. Water is a very, very precious thing. And of course, in Egypt, the water of the Nile is the source of life that everyone depends on for the annual floods down the centuries, back to ancient times, that brought the fertile soil to the Egyptians, for them to live on. So we come to our great story. Pharaoh's daughter adopted the infant Moses, and she it was who gave him his name, Moses. "I will call him Moses," she said, "because I took him from the water." And even after he had reclaimed his Hebrew identity, and he had had to flee his life from the palace, and he had accepted later on that he was the one who had to go back there and challenge Pharaoh and say, "Let my people go." Even after all of that, the name that Pharaoh's daughter gave him stuck. Moses' birth story is a wonderful story, so let's hear it again.
The Nile was very important throughout history and still is today. Some of the world's earliest civilizations started on the banks of the Nile. Ancient Egyptians were very dependent on the river. It gave them water, food, and was used to transport goods for trading. The Pharaoh had commanded that all male Hebrew children would be drowned in the River Nile, but Moses' mother placed him in a basket and hid the basket in the bulrushes by the river bank, where the baby was discovered and adopted by the Pharaoh's daughter and raised as an Egyptian.
We have a bit more context for our story now. Egypt is a great power, and you can visualize some of the great works and buildings and the culture of ancient Egypt. And our story has three great strong characters. Jochebed, Joseph's mother. What? You didn't know Joseph's mother's name was Jochebed? Well, I tell you what, I didn't either. But can you guess who told me? Google. She knows everything. Well, it's amazing how much she knows. But she found a genealogy in chapter 6 of Exodus. And there her name is Jochebed, Moses' mother. And we already know from other stories, we know Miriam's, his sister. And we've just met Pharaoh's daughter. And the Nile that is the source of the life of the people of Egypt. I think about his mother. I wonder what she was thinking when she made that little boat with a basket made out of papyrus leaves and lined with tar and put the child in it and took it down to the river and put it in among the reeds and turned round and walked away. Her daughter, Miriam, Moses' sister, stays, but she turns and walks away. I imagine she might be afraid to look back in case she would run and get him out again. She's already decided that the best chance for him, now that he's 3 months old and she can't hide him anymore, the best chance for him is to let him go, even though she doesn't know what he's going to. Maybe she hoped that the boat would carry him away quite far to a safer place, far away from here. Maybe she hoped that he could just rest gently as she used to rest in the waters of her womb. How hard it was for her to leave him that day. But it happens again and again that people send their children and young people away or flee with them to try and find safety or a better living when they are living in extreme hardship and risk. The community that Moses belonged to first came to Egypt because of a famine in their own land. They were hungry. They came seeking a place where they could find food. And they discovered a great patron, a member of their own family called Joseph, but that's a story for another day. They did well, they settled in, they prospered. They had homes, and they had farms, and they had children, and their community grew and they had friends in high places. But we know that by the time we get to our story, something has gone badly wrong. A new pharaoh has come to power and he resents the good way of life, and maybe others around him are resenting the good way of life that the Hebrew community enjoys. They become slaves. They lose their property. They have to work in the great building works or the farms or in the houses of the Egyptians as slaves. They were first welcomed when they came. But later they became resented. And I think by the time we get to our story, Pharaoh and the Egyptians have become afraid of them. Because otherwise, why is the king going to say, get rid of those boys? This is what has happened. The baby is hidden in a tiny boat. Miriam is hiding, waiting to see what happens. And the basket doesn't move. It's held steady in the reeds with the water gently lapping. And the princess comes and finds it. Her heart opens to it. She sees this child and she says, this is one of those Hebrew babies. She's filled with compassion. Others may have hardened their hearts to this community and convinced themselves that it's all right for these babies' lives to be taken, or turned their faces away from it. But she hasn't, and she doesn't, and she takes him for her son, and she names him. Now, this is Miriam's moment, and she pops up. You're going to need a nurse for this baby. I know somebody who would be a great nurse, totally reliable, just local here. She gets her deal. Did they ever plan this? Some people have suggested this, that the mother thought this might happen. It is true that there are people who are looking for sons. But I think, I have a feeling, this is just almost the incredible thing, and Miriam seizes the moment. We have to think about her coming home with the baby. What does her mother think when she sees Miriam coming in with the baby again? Let's be a fly on the wall and see what they're saying.
Mother! Mother! I've got the baby!
Oh, Miriam, what have you done? Now he's put him back by the river all over again.
No, wait, wait,
no, Miriam's
wait,
not saved!
Wait. Listen, let me explain. The pharaoh's daughter wanted to adopt the baby, so I told her that you would be his wet nurse for the next 2 years.
What a... Oh, Miriam, you brave, brave child. How clever. Oh, thank God, I've never been happier than I am in this moment.
But you only get to keep him for 2 years.
Miriam, if you become a parent, then you will understand that what you want is not as important as what they need. Oh, Miriam, thanks to you, this child will do great things. I believe it is blessed by God. And it will do great, great things because of you.
So, Moses is home again, sitting on his mother's knee. He has a great future ahead of him, and so does Miriam. The Egyptian princess gets mentioned in the Bible once more in the New Testament, in the letter to the Hebrews. By faith, Moses, when he was grown up, refused to be called a son to Pharaoh's daughter. Yes, history takes its course. He discovers his original identity. But she has saved his life. Moses has had a good start because of her good years with his birth family. But the day does come when he has to be taken to the palace and he's still a little boy. Maybe we can eavesdrop again on that day, Moses arriving at the palace.
Hello, little one. Welcome to the palace. It's nice to finally see you here. How are you?
I'm okay, but where's my mother and who is she and why am I here?
I'm going to be your mother now. The nurse has been looking after you for me all these years, and now you can come and live with me in the palace and we can be happy until you're old and you'll be rich and you'll never have to worry about anything again.
But why do you have to be my mother now?
Well, I found you when you were a baby and you were all on your own, and I've always wanted a little son of my own. So I took you in and I've given you to the nurse to raise you until you are old enough to come and live with me.
How long am I going to stay here?
For all your life.
It's a lot for a child to take in, to cope with a move like that. And of course, we still have children in this kind of position, turning up here. Very young people turn up, make their way here. Others get stuck waiting to get in. And there's still children with relations here who are waiting to get into our country. The resources of our earth are plentiful, but we still find it very difficult to share. Even to give everyone access to a cup of cold water, a cup of clean cold water. Although we know that when we give, as the gospel promises, it will bless us as well as those to whom we give something. Sharing of water is difficult on the individual scale, getting it to all those individual people who need it. And it's difficult on the macro scale. At least 9 nations share the waters of the Nile and its main tributaries, all the way down Egypt, Sudan, in Ethiopia, down as far as Burundi and Rwanda. There's uncertainty about which should be called the place of the source of the White Nile, which is one of the biggest tributaries. How many people depend on it? How many nations? How many individual, different, distinct communities? They all have their needs and tremendous difficulty in agreeing about dams and distribution, and they need the power, the hydroelectric power that a dam can bring. And there are international fingers in the pie as well. As we struggle with sharing, we do so from the very beginning of our lives. It's what we have to try and teach people in the nursery. It's what we have to teach our little people. But this struggle about it goes on. In our story, the Hebrews have gone to Egypt because of famine. And people are still fleeing because of famine and poverty and because of war. They send out young people not knowing if they will ever see them again. Our friends in the Finsbury Park Mosque, the sisters, went on a wonderful visit to the British Museum last year. 40 of us went, full of objects that in these newly hung Islamic galleries were things that lots and lots of women recognized and associated with their homes and the many different parts of the Islamic world that they came from. Along with some of these great ancient treasures were some new commissions. One of them was a little boat. It was very small, smaller than the one that Moses went to see, and it was made of two bits of a bicycle's mudguard. And it was filled with matchsticks that had been struck, standing vertically, all the people standing up in the boat. And underneath it, there was a little poem that talked about people going to sea and using their phones to try and navigate where they were getting to go, using their phones for a bit of light and as a navigation tool. Their lives are so different from ours, and the risks they face are so great. You remember that we always had a table in St. Thomas's for food, non-perishable food and other gifts to be left for the refugees and asylum seekers. I had a look before when I was thinking about this story, and the Islington Centre for Refugees and Migrants is still working for them. It's not open for people to visit, and its courses, its English language courses, are being done online. But it's still sending out essential supplies, people food, and top up the mobile phones, which these are essential for these people to be able to communicate with others and to stay in touch. So there are still ways that they can help and we can help. And so as we think about Moses and to think about the great life that lay ahead of him, we value the work that these people do. In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father. We wait for you, O God. Our souls wait for you, O God. And in your word, we hope, more than those who watch for the morning, more than those who watch for the morning.
Father, we pray for your people throughout the world, today in particular for Prem Chand Singh, moderator and Bishop of Jabalpur, for St. George and All Saints, Tufnell Park, and Alexander Lilly, the priest in charge, and Sharon Angel, the parish administrator. For those at St. Thomas's who have volunteered to open the church for private prayer.
Lord, I pray that this virus will soon end so that we can go back to our normal lives. Amen.
We pray for the people of Brazil as the coronavirus continues to spread. We ask that their resources are used wisely to help tackle further spreading. In this country, we bring before you the people of Reading after the horrific attack there, praying for the victims and their families and for the local community as they come to terms with events in their town. We pray for the staff of businesses up and down the country as they prepare for work in an environment much changed. Amongst your people in this diocese and deanery, we pray for this parish, our neighbours in Highbury Stadium Square and Arsenal Football Club. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We ask your blessing during the coming year for those whose birthdays are at this time. Matthew Smith, Tonya Payne, Juliet Mountain and Fiona Harvey.
Lord, protect our loved ones. Amen.
We pray for those for whom prayer is asked. Cynthia France, Nick and Michelle Wooldridge, Stella Stavrou, Paul Crozier and Nick Armstrong, Maria, Andrea Loven and family, Melissa and Grayson, Jill, Catherine, Elliot and Grace Dawson, Hazel, John, Irene, Jean and Nigel, Ewa, Sheila, Charles Hadaway, Duncan, Malcolm, Jane, Nikki and Zoe, Patience and Virginia, Aileen Massey and Fiona Goodhart, Julia and family, Costa, Helena Kidd, the Bradbury family, Jean, Colette, Mary Mortel, Mickey, Bob, Olwen Howard, Irene, the Rubiani family, Selena Graham family, Sebastian Rook Lay, John, Margaret and Cara Armitage, Tungi Lamosh, Christopher Fowler, Pete Chapman, Lynn and Andrew Henderson, Andreas and Thomas Sprecht. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We remember the departed. Amongst those who have died recently, we pray for Henry Frant, and of those the anniversary of whose deaths are at this time, we remember in particular Anna Heaton, Dennis O'Kill, Ron Whitehouse, Francis King, and Phoebe Ware. We bring before you those whose lives have been cut short by accident, violence, or natural disaster. We pray for those who in despair have been driven to take their own lives, and for anyone who has no one to pray for them. We give thanks for those who through their lives have brought others closer to you, and as we join our prayers with you, those of all the saints, but especially those of the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of your Son, Thomas the Apostle, John the Evangelist, and John the Baptist, we bring our own prayers to you in silence.
Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us gather our prayers and praises into one in the words that our Saviour taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We have some notices for you today. As usual, at the end of our service, there will be a Zoom coffee at 11:15. Morning prayer on Wednesday at 9 o'clock. Bible study Friday at 2 o'clock on Zoom. And that is the series called Encountering the God Who Speaks. And each takes one very interesting encounter with a character in the Bible. And the next Friday's character is Samuel. The session is 40 minutes. There is a series of them, but each one is complete in itself. Next Sunday, the 5th of July, will be our patronal festival, and our visiting preacher will be the Reverend Peter Bernhardt. This will be followed by a Zoom coffee as usual, and at 6 o'clock we will have the patronal party on Zoom, and we ask you to come to that and bring your stories about St. Thomas's. In a few moments, we will be joining in our final song, This Little Light of Mine. But first, the blessing. God give you grace to follow his saints in faith and hope and love, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Abide in the peace of Christ.
Amen. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. The light that shines is the light of love. Lights the darkness from above. Shines on me and shines on you. Shows what the power of love can do. I'm gonna shine my light both far and near. I'm gonna shine my light bright and clear. Where there's a dark corner in this land, I'm gonna let my little light shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Monday gave me the gift of love. Tuesday peace came from above. On Wednesday he told me to have my faith. On Thursday he gave me just a little more grace. Friday he told me just to watch and pray. Saturday he told me what to say. Sunday he gave me the power divine to let my little light shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Gonna let it shine, gonna let it shine, gonna let it shine, gonna let it shine, gonna let it shine.
Gonna let this light shine.